If you thought that you were supposed to take a break today, that's not true. It is not true. Welcome to the video. This video is for those who have repentant minds only. Otherwise, you're just going to get very irritated. The ones who have recognized and have repented and said, yeah, I do, the arrogance is the problem, then they don't get so irritated. They don't get confused. They see past the level of confusion that words inherently suggest, concepts inherently suggest a potential confusion. You can think that an implied confusion, whereas if the mood of repentance says, I'm not going to stumble over concepts and words. I understand the direction that we're going in here. So for all repentant minds, welcome to the video. And again, we're not taking a day off today. We're not taking a day off. Just the opposite. Trying even more strongly to get to the truth, because we need to. Now, the basic problem that we face is that we're believing that arrogance is truth and truth is arrogance. Okay, this is called the belief system of arrogance. It believes arrogance is true and that truth is arrogant. Okay, completely upside down and backwards. And this basic belief system is extraordinarily challenging to get free of this, because it's so completely upside down and backwards. It's a huge challenge. I've been working at this challenge my whole life, and seeing more and more and more. Wow, I'm seeing, you know, more clearly the outlines of this issue that we have. It's a very severe issue, so we have to be patient with it. We have to look at it and keep looking at it. Now, what arrogance does is it defends itself. This is all based on a desire of spirit, which is what we are. When I say talking about us, I mean spirit, not body. Spirit wanted to be greater than God. This is the root of this thing, and we've gone over this many, many, many times of why arrogance arose, etc. So, but right now we're going to look at the primary defense of arrogance. There's a huge amount of defensive systems that arrogance uses to try and confuse the issue in our minds. And ultimately what arrogance comes up with is that it claims that that when you finally say, hey, this is a mistake, you know, to say that arrogance is truth and truth is arrogant is a mistake. Arrogance will say, well, I'll tell you what, let's make a deal. And it will say, I'm willing to say that arrogance isn't true if you're willing to say that truth isn't true. Okay, and what arrogance says is, let's make this new truth where both arrogance and truth are true. Okay, let's make this new truth. That's fair. So what it does is it says it's being fair. This is the idea of equality, fairness. This is all code for compromise or a new reality in which both arrogance and truth are true. And then, okay, so then arrogance ultimately claims that there's a way to accept this. Once you accept within your being that this new reality is true, is better than the old reality, actually, but better than both reality and arrogance, that you'll be happy and satisfied with that. And then when you're not, it says, well, it's up to you, and you have to use your will to accept this. And you're somehow blocking yourself from accepting this. And when you try to combine both truth and lies into a new truth, what you experience is what's called total mental chaos. Total mental chaos. Total mental chaos. And you jump back and say, wow, I cannot abide in that. It's not possible. Then arrogance claims that it's your fault, not the fault of the idea of truth and lies both being true, but it's your own weakness that it prevented you from you know, creating this new fusion, this new reality. And then so blames you, puts all the blame on you instead of saying, hey, this idea of a compromise is false. It doesn't work. At that point, what do you do? At that point, what do you do? And this is what I've discovered, that you realize, wow, it doesn't work. And then do you accept all the blame and say, well, I'll never be happy until I manage to get this to work? Or you say, maybe it's unworkable no matter how much I try. This is the interesting dilemma that you face. And then you realize, hey, truth tells you, wait a minute, this will never work. And then you work on then setting arrogance down. And this can be a work of a lifetime, actually. It can be done right this instant, but practically speaking, we're going to honor our beliefs in time, and believe that it takes time. And so, and for purpose of continuity fear, we'll say, well, I better go at this gradually. And so pragmatically, it can take quite a bit of time and effort to set arrogance aside and say, no, that doesn't work. And so this is the situation that we're all faced. All of existence is based on arrogance, okay? In terms of what we think of it of as existence, that's all just arrogance. Belief in time, space, process, and form, all sheer arrogance. The whole electromagnetic cosmos is nothing but arrogance. It's a picture of arrogance. It's actually evidence that we have manufactured to support arrogance, that say that arrogance is true, that we have the evidence here, that there's a design to perfect arrogance, that there's a contest with God, and we're working to perfect arrogance. And so all of this cosmos of electromagnetism is really designed to give evidence that competition and progress and evolution and all of this is true, and that supports the notion that arrogance is actually is true, and that truth is arrogance. So you might say the whole cosmos of electromagnetism and the planets and the forms and everything is a dream that we have imagined to support our belief that that arrogance is true and that truth is arrogance. So in line with how we practice, we always take it some stop and for the wow. Okay, this is very important. This is not just a discussion, an argument, a discussion, a debate, anything like that. What we do is we try to bring up the most intense depiction and focus on truth as possible. And then we allow ourselves to preemptively, we take a break and say, coast for a little while. And preempt the backlash. The backlash. It's a way of preempting the backlash. So we have just said the entire cosmos, electromagnetic cosmos, is manufactured evidence that we, Spirit, Son of God, has imagined all of this, is projecting all of it. Mental is a mental projection, an appearance in pure spaciousness designed to, as evidence, to support our belief that arrogance is true and that truth is arrogance. And that when we try to get free of this delusion, then the final defense that arrogance throws up is this compromise. Throws it up. And we're in such a time right now in this world where compromise is being used as a defense mechanism to defend arrogance, because we were getting very close to seeing through arrogance. What happens when we get close to it, then this defense becomes all important. And what arrogance says is that it has to market this idea of a new reality. And so it dresses it up. And this is where the idea of the goddess enters in, or the mother says, oh, well, there's a new reality. It comes from the mother. You know, the father is seen now as truth. Truth is seen as not is not true, and arrogance also is seen as not true. So we say that neither one is true, but there's a new reality where both are true. You see, neither one is true in itself, okay? But there's a new reality where both are seen as true. And this is the mother, the goddess, this is a great marketing device that the arrogance uses to make us feel like this is the way to go. Compromise. And we're told, like, well, yeah, that the reason why we haven't seen it is because we've been too arrogant, or too extreme or arrogant. And yet the mother is all inclusive. She's all benign. She's all knows how to moderate disputes. You know, the great moderator is held up as the ideal in society. The female as the great moderator, moderating between truth and arrogance, truth and lies, and that she's tolerant and all-inclusive and compassionate. And so she, within her, she's able to have both truth and lies true, you see. This is how arrogance operates. It's a defense system that arrogance uses. And this is what's being used in the world right now. This is why the world is taking the turn that it has taken. And this trips us up. It trips us up very badly. And so this has to be brought to light. Otherwise, we will fail, for sure. If we pursue this so-called compromise under the guise of this some benevolent intercessor who's able to moderate between arrogance and truth, and like hey boy, like a couple of squabbling boys, you know, it's depicted like a couple of squabbling men or boys who are fighting over some stupid little game, and the mother comes in and says, now boys, you know, settle down, you know, both are true, don't worry, we have room for both truth and lies in this in the heart of the mother. You know, this is what is being taught, and this has been taught now in this world very strongly for the last half century or more. Actually, it's become the new world religion. What's really taking place in this world is there's a new world religion being forced on everybody by propaganda, by severe propaganda. And they don't even realize what's taking place, really. They're just going along, like, okay, I accept this. They don't understand that the catechism of this new world religion is being taught to everybody through the media, through the politicians, through entertainment, through the propaganda mill, the vast propaganda mill that the world has now. The catechism of the new world religion is being taught. And these people in the world now are fanatically religious about this new world religion. And these activists in the world right now are actually missionaries for the new world religion. And this new world religion is based on the idea that both truth and lies can be true. And this will enter into this more tolerant society, more inclusive society, that we say, wow, reality is so exclusive. It doesn't include arrogance, that reality isn't true. Gee, you know, how intolerant can it possibly be? Yeah, it's terrible. Terrible intolerance. That perfection cannot admit that it's not perfect. It cannot allow imperfection. You know, how intolerant that is. This is what's taking place in this world, which is why it's such a dangerous time. This is the final defense of arrogance, or the ego, that Jesus calls it, the ego. The arrogance, I've used the term arrogance because it tends to, for me, it has a stronger bite to it. The ego's kind of just a bland sort of term, like, oh, you know, psychoanalytic term or something. But arrogance, really, you know, you can feel like, wow, it's not a good thing. It's not. And again, to arrogate means to claim that reality has some quality to it that God didn't create. That's arrogance. So to think that reality could now include a quality of denying that it's perfect, denying that it's real, all right, divine, that's arrogance. That's sheer arrogance. So this compromise is absolute arrogance, and it's the most insidious form of arrogance. This so-called compromise, where we're able to blend both truth and lies, is the most insidious form of arrogance by far. So this is kind of like the final test for us here. If we're able to see through this, then, you know, we have passed the test, so to speak. If we don't see through it, we're going to be thrown back into, you know, the pit of darkness, a really very dark pit of ignorance, actually. So there's been this massive marketing campaign that claims that women have the answer, that they're more tolerant, that they can moderate, they're the expert moderators. See, what the arrogance tells us, like, we just need an expert moderator to bring these two sides in conflict with one another into an agreement, you see, a compromise. And so we believe that there's this great mother moderator that's able to do this. Okay, this is absolutely not true. Absolutely not true. This is sheer arrogance. God is not in conflict with arrogance at all. There's no contest taking place at all. This is what Jesus tells us. There's no contest taking place. Truth is not in opposition to anything, because truth is all there is. Right? It's not, there isn't a part of reality that's a lie. There isn't any part of reality that's a lie. It's nothing but sheer arrogance to believe this. Arrogance is to believe in something that doesn't exist. Okay? Lies don't exist in reality. So there is no contest taking place. So there's nothing to moderate. There's nothing to moderate. There's no compromise to agree to at all. These are all just delaying tactics of arrogance until it believes it can perfect itself and defeat God in a contest. It thinks that power, the authority of the prime creator is something that is up for grabs in a contest, that it's being contested right now, and it's not. It's absolutely not being contested in any way. So the more we work on this, the better off we are. And you know, it's absolutely taboo in this world right now to speak out and bring to light this compromise attempt, because this seems to be our only hope. See, we've been told for the last half century that women are going to save the world, particularly Western women, but women in general, because the very nature is that they're moderators. You know, that they moderate squabbles among their children, and so the only hope we have is to throw our fate in the hands of women, and that they have some inherent great capacity to resolve the problem for us. This is a total lie of arrogance, okay? Because what they're really marketing to you is this so-called compromise where we're able to get both reality, truth, and lies to agree that they'll both give up their position for a new position where both of them are true. Why would truth want to agree to such something? Truth is already true. How is that a compromise? That's why does truth need to compromise? It can't, actually. But why would it even want to? It's already perfect. It's already true. Why should it say, no, I'm going to agree I'm not perfect, just so I can let lies in? You know, it's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. And needs to be seen that it is totally ridiculous, actually. And then, of course, the world say, oh, you're saying that women are ridiculous or something. So they've made it, they market it in such a way as if you see through it and say, this is not true, this is not the way, that somehow you're disrespecting women or something. Well, no, it's arrogance that's disrespecting women by arrogantly claiming that they have a quality that they don't have. That's extremely disrespectful and harmful to them, puts them in an untenable position. So it's arrogance that should back off making this ridiculous claim that somehow women have this magical moderating power that is able to integrate both truth and lies and get both of them to agree to this new solution where both are true. That is absolute sheer arrogance, okay? So it's arrogance that has to stop making this crazy, untenable claim which puts women in a completely untenable position. See? That's to blame. Arrogance is to blame. Not truth at all. Truth never said that women have some special ability to forge a compromise between truth and lies. It's never been said in any spiritual teaching. That's completely untrue. In fact, they explicitly point out that this is not true, knowing that this is the trick that arrogance uses. So when you look at religions and you say, well, they're misogynistic, it's not, you know. No, they're explicitly pointing out the trap that arrogance tries to spring upon us of this moderating influence of the Great Mother. Okay, because it's been used throughout this whole saga of this dream of arrogance. Arrogance has used this as its final resort, a compromise. So of course religion has to point that out to us. It points it out to both men and women. It points it out to women. Don't get sucked in. Don't buy into this untenable position. Don't allow arrogance to arrogate to you a quality that you don't have. Because then you're going to feel very insecure, and then you're going to start blaming, projecting your insecurity, and insisting that someone, that the men are causing that you to feel that insecure, and then blaming them and attacking them, and you completely lose your all credibility. What, you know, you'll lose credibility. You'll lose your way. You'll lose your way. So of course, those who are helping free us from arrogance have to point out this extraordinarily clever, or not, it's just the vicious defense that arrogance uses to maintain its position. And it's a delaying tactic, and arrogance insists that it can perfect itself. So it says it just needs a little more time. It always is buying time. Arrogance is always buying time. That's all that it does. All that arrogance does is buys time, which is completely meaningless and futile. There's no such thing as perfecting arrogance. But what can arrogance do except buy time? That's all it can do. And so this is its you know, ultimate trick to buy time. And it seems to be very divisive in society. So this is why religion has been the way that it has been. And the women are told the same as the men. You must avoid this trick that arrogance uses that suggests that we can make both truth and lies true, and that this is going to be the answer that we're searching for. No, the answer that we're searching for is that truth is true and lies are never true. That's the answer that we're searching for. Truth is true and lies are never true. Will never be true. There's no exception to this. No exception to it. That's the answer we're searching for. That answer doesn't come from the great mother moderator at all. And then arrogance says, well, see, women are being disrespected. No, because there's no such thing as men or women. We're spirit. We're not body. We're spirit. And there's no gender in spirit. There's neither male nor female in spirit whatsoever. So it's arrogance that's disrespecting truth. That's the problem. The problem is not any misogyny, it is arrogance. That's the problem. And arrogance is completely disrespecting and denying truth, actually. Trying to change it. Saying it's changeable, which is saying that God, the will of God is changeable, that we have a spirit that has a stronger will than God. So, seeing arrogance is extraordinarily tricky and clever. And like I said, for me, it's been a very difficult odyssey to recognize this. I have to work at it every day, because arrogance keeps whatever trick it can play on you, it will play that trick. It will continue to keep trying, pressuring you, and it shows us just how intense our creativity can be, how we can delude ourselves so severely. And of course, arrogance believes again that arrogance is true and that truth is arrogant. So when you express the truth, arrogance just claims that you're being arrogant. That's what it claims, and therefore it doesn't have to listen to you. That you need to change. And if you say no, I don't want to change, then it turns to this moderator. Say, Great Mother, we have this impassable debate here. We cannot resolve it. It's up to you to resolve it. We fall at your feet and ask for your mercy, and please help moderate this, because otherwise we don't have any idea how we can ever resolve this, etc. And it's an emotional kind of situation, because reason does resolve it. Emotion cannot resolve it, that is for sure. But reason absolutely can resolve it and see through it. Absolutely. That's why the Holy Spirit is called the voice of reason. It's not called the voice of emotion. It's called the voice of reason. And so the arrogance constantly tries to keep marketing in this world of that we need to give equal credence to this idea of compromise, that we must honor this idea of compromise, of having both lies and truth true, that we must honor this idea. And if we don't honor it, then we're wicked. You know, this is that we're bad, that we're wicked, that we're they're intolerant, that we're discriminatory. You know, just it throws every slander it can possibly throw at us if we don't honor arrogance equally with truth, really is what it's saying. And of course, we can't do that. It's impossible to join the two. I tried, and I found out it's impossible. And the price we pay is this total mental chaos, which is insufferable. So again, arrogance is just nothing but a total liar. It's a total lie, 100%, and has to be set down. It's just a belief system. It's never done anything to reality. It's never touched reality. Never will touch reality. And we can see that this is true. So this is the tough work that we have to do every day. As we get up in the morning, we have to continue to try and clarify. And every moment of our day is an opportunity. This is what I see. That everything is an opportunity to use your reason. And you can look at how crazy the world is. Those who are pursuing this compromise are really out to lunch. Really out to lunch. And of course, they don't see that at all. They think that they are ushering in this new age, which is vastly better than anything that could ever possibly have come before. This new age of compromise, of both truth and lies being true. So they feel that they're the heroines and heroes of this new age, and that they've got it right and you've got it all wrong. And this is the pressure that everyone is under on this planet right now. All praise to Jesus Christ, who gave us this information to help us with this. Without this information, for sure, I would have fallen prey to all this. I don't know how anyone could not. It's so intense right now. So A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and the other voice, which is information that Jesus gave us about all of this, was super, super helpful to be able to see through this intense, intense marketing campaign, propaganda campaign that the world has been undergoing, that arrogance has been presenting to us, to convince us that, you know, that arrogance has the answer. Compromise. Both truth and lies are true. And we think, wow, look how all-inclusive we are. Look how, you know, such and such and such and such and such. That's like saying that all-inclusivity and non-inclusivity are both all-inclusive. You know, it's a new inclusivity where it's both inclusive and non-inclusive. This makes a mockery of teachings. It makes a mockery of it. But it sounds very Zen or very Dzogchen-like, right? That pure spaciousness is both spontaneously all-inclusive and also non-spontaneous, non-inclusive. It's both, you know. That is not true. It's a mockery of this teaching. But it sounds very spiritual, doesn't it? Arrogance has been able to dress it up so it sounds very spiritual, and then it's put a dress on it and saying, you know, it's the mother is here to resolve our disputes, that kind of thing. This is the impression that arrogance gets. And this is such a strong belief system that this is the answer. This is what's going to free us from all our disputes. In other words, we think that this is how to end all war. This is how to end all conflict. This is all how to end all disputes. Keep in mind that all disputes arise within the belief system of arrogance. Arrogance splitting itself off into different factions and projecting and destroy, project and destroy. There's no dispute with God at all. There's no conflict within God at all. It's within arrogance that all conflict arises. So the idea of continuing to accept the advice of arrogance is somehow going to bring peace and freedom from dispute is, again, sheer arrogance. Sheer arrogance. Nothing other than that. And yet the world is all in on this. So if you don't go all in on it, they claim that you're the reason why there's conflict. You're the reason why there's lack of peace. You're the reason why there's disputes. You're the reason blah, 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 blah. In other words, they scapegoat you and say, you're to blame, instead of recognizing that it's arrogance to blame. So the unrepentant mind easily falls into this New World Order, New World Religion of the Mother as the great moderator, bringing about a hitherto an inaccessible peace where God no longer claims that God is perfect, and arrogance no longer claims that arrogance is true, that we now have that it's both true, some integration, some amalgamation, a combination of the two, so to speak. Both lies and truth are true. This is the Great Mother raises up her hands and proclaims that both truth and lies are true, and within her being she's able to embody both, you know. And now you can enjoy this electromagnetic universe as her body, where because it's all going to be peaceful now, except first you have to exterminate all those who have rejected this great her great divinity or something. You have to exterminate all of them. And then so you go out and, you know, spend the rest of your, spend millions of years on extermination missions, you know. So yeah, as soon as you exterminate everyone who disagrees with you, with this compromise solution, then you'll be happy. So, see, arrogance always has a proviso for more time, always. As soon as you integrate the two in your mind, then you'll be happy. Oh, you can't do it? Well, you need some more time then. It's your fault. You're stupid. You have a lack of will. You need to evolve your will and make your will stronger. This whole idea of evolution is nonsense, that you're trying to evolve your will. Arrogance says you need to evolve your will to be strong enough to integrate the two, to accept this great solution that the Great Mother has for you. And that if you can't accept it, that's a lack of will, and then you need to spend more time, more incarnations, keep incarnating, keep building your will. This is arrogance. You don't need any incarnations. You don't need to do anything. There is no compromise. There's no compromise at all with truth. There is healed perception, but healed perception is not saying that both truth and lies are true. Healed perception says only truth is true, but it's perceiving it, and there's one more half step of knowing it, that's all. But it's not a compromise, it's not. It's just a continuity issue, is all. And of course, arrogance tries to confuse that issue too. It survives by confusion. Survives by lies and confusion, continually trying to confuse the issue so that you can't see how clearly delineated they are, the difference. And this is what makes the path very difficult, is arrogance's use of confusion. You might get it clear for a little while, and then the clouds of confusion roll back in, and you say, oh gosh, this is terrible. Yeah, it's very terrible. So if you reject this compromise plan of arrogance, people think that you're the worst person in the world. You know, you're just like absolutely, this is the trouble right now, is nobody's willing to be seen that way. Almost nobody is willing to be seen as the absolute villain. You know, this is the one who is, you know, causing all the hang-ups here. And if it weren't for this one, this compromise solution would work and we'd all be happy forever after. No more war, nothing but peace and happiness. You know, this is what we're told. Nothing but propaganda and lies. And the weaker-minded you are, the more arrogant you are, actually, the easier it is to fall into this trap. And the more you've worked on setting your arrogance down, the more resistant you are to falling into this trap. Called the Great Mother Trap. The Great Mother Trap is the worst trap of all. And I've been through that, and I know all about it. Terrible, terrible trap. Where everything is ultimately, your failure is, of course, all blamed on you. And at that point, you feel that there's, you know, you rejected truth, and supposedly you think arrogance, for this new compromise, and then they find out you can't do it. It's not doable, and then it's all blamed on you. It's all your fault, your weakness. And then you feel like, wow, there's just nothing I can do at all. And then you just feel like, you know, arrogance rises in to get you to destroy yourself. It's really trying to get truth to destroy itself. It's terrible. So before you become, you know, super hostile towards truth here in this world, keep in mind the direction that most of the world are going is they're going to a dead end. They're going into a dead end because sooner or later they're going to experience that this compromise doesn't work. There's no possibility it can work. And then arrogance is going to blame them. They're just going to blame them for its failure to work. So you might be thinking, well, what is this YouTube channel all really about? What's the big deal? But, well, it is a big deal because eventually this is going to happen to everyone. And so you will certainly want to have, at that point, those who are aware of this and have a healed mind and have dropped this, you know, arrogance and understand this situation to encourage you and reassure you. Otherwise, you're going to feel you don't have any options. Now, the Holy Spirit is always with us, so at this point you ask for help and the Holy Spirit is there and you recognize something is there to help you. But it's also important that you have examples of those who have been seen through this delusion, because you might be thinking, I don't understand, you know, what went wrong. It's all my fault. I need to incarnate a million times now to try to, I don't know if I'll ever be able to build up the will. You know, where do I go? You just feel like there's nothing left for you to pursue, you know, and you don't even realize how you got trapped so badly. It's a horrible situation. And I can see that almost everyone in this world is going right into that trap. But again, at some point down the road, you're going to realize, wow, I'm really in a tough spot now and not sure how to get out of it. So there are teachers who help us. There are those who've gone before and have freed themselves from arrogance, who say, you can do it. You can do it. I had teachers help me out. So you can do it. You're going to do it for sure. It's not as difficult as you think. It's just a little trick that you played on yourself. And that is all that it is, really. But at this time in history, anyone who is really enlightened and comes here and speaks the truth would certainly be seen by most to be an obstructionist who is trying to negate this new reality. Okay, that's old-fashioned, you know, old-fashioned. There is the new world religion is all about attacking the old religion. The old religion actually was a challenge to us to work on our arrogance. And what else is religion, actually, but a challenge for us to work on freeing ourselves from our arrogance, to repent, to forgive ourselves for our arrogance and set it down. That's all that religion is. It's all religion. No matter what teacher you want to talk about, what tradition you want to talk about, it's all the same. All the same, it's a challenge to us to set our arrogance down. That's plain and simple. And there's no reason for any different religions to be in arguing with one another. All that is distraction that arrogance is bringing up. Maybe the flavor of the challenge, you know, will differ a little bit here, a little bit there, in different areas of the world, and cosmos, etc. But it's all the same challenge. It's a challenge to set your arrogance down. That's it. All of it. Not to settle, not to believe in any compromise whatsoever. Not to believe that there's any exception to reality. The belief that there's an exception to reality, that is arrogance. That's what we're talking about, that there's some exception, that it's not perfect. Reality, there's no exception to reality. Reality is perfect. Okay, so when we make even one little exception, that's sheer arrogance. And it's entirely arrogant. There's no truth to it whatsoever. Completely arrogant. And if we fail to recognize that, then we are indeed will be caught up in the defense systems of arrogance, which seem to be quite mighty and confusing. Mighty confusing. And they are. Confusion is the defense system to a large extent, right? And then this compromise solution, once you start clarifying it, arrogance springs this final solution upon us. And arrogance, it also uses the divide and conquer thing, where it tries to stir up debate and argument between different religious traditions. It tries to stir that up, and you know, divide and conquer sort of thing. And I say, just reject all that. Reject all that. In other words, stay humble. Don't engage in any arguments, no matter what. And just continue in examining arrogance and see through its defenses, and keep working on putting it down, and losing your continuity fear and putting it down. And ultimately, where you arrive at is where everyone who's arrived. I've had different teachers from different traditions reassure me that I'm on the right path, and don't worry about these differences in religions. I've had those from Buddhism, from Hinduism, Advaita Vedanta, which is a type of, it's a type of Hinduism, you might say, and those from Christianity, all tell me, yes, keep going in this direction. Just follow it all the way to the end. You'll be fine. You'll realize truth. No hang-ups on theology or none of that stuff. None of that stuff. Don't get hung up on anything. All hang-ups are just arrogance, actually. It's buying time. Buying time. Arrogance is the great expert at buying time. And if you want to buy time, arrogance will buy it for you. And then it will present it to you in the form of an argument, a puzzle, or something like, well, wait a minute, you know, this concept says this, and this is this. It's kind of like, what do you mean? What you call that water, and I call it H2O, and well, we really can't be sure what it is, can we? We can't really drink it yet until we resolve this conflict. Let's go to the Great Mother, maybe, and she'll resolve it for us, you know, instead of drinking the water, drinking the liquid. Say, wait a minute, we've got a conflict here, we've got a disagreement here, I can't understand what's going on. This is just buying time. All this is buying time. So we need to be humble enough to recognize that it's our continuity fear that leads to buying time. So when there's an invitation to conflict, we need to say no to it. No, that's not what, I don't really want that, no. That's just buying time, I don't need it. I can practice instead, which dissolves our continuity fear. The more we dissolve our continuity fear, the less time we need to buy. The less time we need to buy, the easier it is to see through the cleverness of arrogance. Jesus used ego as a psychoanalytic term because when he had to introduce the teachings at a certain time frame, so we would have an opportunity to get familiar with them before the real severity of this new world religion, where this catechism is now to try to force it upon everyone. So he had to come in and he had to get this information to us, and so it was the psychoanalytic age that we happened to be in at that time, and they used the term ego. And so he needed to introduce, make a start. So he used the term ego to start with, and which is perfectly pragmatic. I don't have any problems with the pragmatism of A Course in Miracles, understanding that it needed to come to have a birth into this world, so it could grow up before this extreme crisis took place. So we'd be strong enough to see through this compromise of the Great Mother. We'd be smart enough and clear enough to recognize, hey, that's fault. That's the great lie, the great deception, the great falsity. So it just used the term ego starting out, but I would say arrogance is a stronger, has more punch to it, has a lot more punch to it, and it is more descriptive at this phase. It's not nice. Arrogance not nice. It's not nice at all. It's an arch deceiver. It's an arch villain, as it were. It's demanding, the death of perfection, which is all there is. It's really demanding the annihilation of all it is. That's not nice at all. So I say it's sheer arrogance. In other words, there's no part of arrogance that isn't sheer arrogance. Arrogance is all sheer arrogance. The belief that we're a body in a world, in a situation we call a cosmos, electromagnetic light, belief that that's real light and all this is sheer arrogance. It's a dream. It's a dream. It's a mental projection that spirit is using to back up its claims of imperfection. This kind of thing, it says, look, God, look at everything here. Look at this whole cosmos, See, this is what you have done. This is your work, not ours. And God says, no, it's your work, not mine. And you've done that to manufacture evidence, false evidence. And we say, no, God, how could we do that? It's such a great, massive creation. We could have never done that. And God says, well, keep in mind, I extended myself as you, so you have all the same power I do, except you can't change what I am. You cannot change what I am. You cannot change reality, but you still have the same creative power. So whatever I can create, you can create too. Except the direction of creation, you cannot create that. So we can create a whole cosmos, absolutely. No trouble at all for us, actually. In fact, Jesus says that this whole cosmos is just a tiny fraction of one drop of our creative capacity. And we have imagined all this to back up our claim of imperfection, and therefore claim that arrogance is true. Manufacturing evidence. That's all it is. It's manufactured evidence. Nothing more than that. And so there's no value in it, actually, as Jesus tells us. There's nothing to value, not only in this world, but in this universe. There's absolutely nothing to value. Those who are valuing it are actually pursuing the Great Mother compromise lie. Absolutely they are. Absolutely are. And this has been rampant over the last 50 some odd years. It's been a fanatical effort on part of this world. That's all I've ever experienced since I got to this world, is this obsessive attempt to bring in this compromise of the Great Mother on the part of arrogance, because arrogance got really spooked. There's all these spiritual teachers, they're teaching truth, and arrogance got very, very, very frightened and said, well, I gotta use this, you know, my ultimate defense here. And of course, like we're told, well, who can criticize their mother? See, it's the mother that's bringing this, the Great Mother, the mother of all mothers, who's bringing this solution, the great moderator of all moderators. And I've pointed out, you know, anyway, this is, who can argue against that? If they're terrible, who can do that? Nobody, you know, like as if truth is somehow paralyzed by the idea of some bag of flesh, you know, some mother bag of flesh that has to be right. Whatever this bag of flesh says must be right. It's utterly ridiculous. Again, this entire universe is a make-believe manufactured evidence, make-believe manufactured dream evidence that reality isn't perfect. So it's utter nonsense to claim some symbol must be inherently right. Some bag of flesh must be inherently right. It's complete nonsense. Complete sheer arrogance. Again, sheer arrogance. And then arrogance will claim, oh, but you're trying to attack me. You're trying to attack me. No, truth is not attacking anything. Truth is just true. It's arrogance that's trying to attack reality by claiming it's not perfect. Arrogance is really trying to annihilate reality. And so, again, the basic premise of arrogance is that arrogance is true and truth is arrogance. So the idea that truth says, I can't be attacked, arrogance says, you're attacking arrogance by saying that. You're saying that arrogance isn't true. You're attacking arrogance. So if we accept this belief of arrogance, that reality is attacking arrogance by simply being true, then you've entered absurdity. You've entered a whimsical absurdity where there's no reason, where all reason is completely meaningless, where the direction of creation is completely meaningless, which is, you know, absurd whimsicality. And is absurd whimsicality true? There's no meaning then to truth at all. So then you end up to this nihilistic nowhereness, kind of, where just saying, wow, there is no truth. There is no truth whatsoever. Can't be. And again, it's absurd. Let's say there's no direction to creation. There's no prime creator. There's no prime created. So that's arrogance too. To claim that there's no truth is arrogance. Absolutely it is. So this whole relativism that we think that we're so smart, that the Great Mother is moderating, say no, you need to realize that both truth and lies are true, and we're not going to try to say one is right and the other is wrong. That's not fair. It's not fair or equal. You know, how bad, how wrong of you. This is, you know, the ugliest face of arrogance there is. And of course, arrogance says, well, that's not fair. You're saying this is the ugliest face. That's not right. You know, well, what do you mean it's not right? It's true. That, you know, we have no choice but to set arrogance down. And we have no choice to recognize, you know, its most clever defenses as being, you know, the most clever defense. And since we're setting it all down together, we're not drawing any distinction about what remains and what doesn't remain, and none of it remains. So it's meaningless in terms of what's the most cleverest in terms of judgment. It's not a judgment on arrogance. It's just a recognition that we need to set all of it down without any exception, that there's no exception to truth. So there's no part of arrogance that is more true than some other part. It's all lies are equally lies. There's no lie that is true. But trying to teach this in this world right now seems prohibitively difficult. I've had the opportunity to work on it for 38 years, and for the Course in Miracles, intensely, 38 years of absolute emergency intensity. So of course I have familiarity with it now, and so I'm able to speak up like this. But if you don't have this sort of familiarity right now, good luck trying to speak up on this. Good luck. I don't see anybody doing it. And it's probably coming very difficult for anyone even to listen to this. Because they say, oh my gosh, what if I have to speak up on this? You know, I'll be crushed. Yeah. That's the aim of the New World Religion, is to crush us all. I'll crush us to that anybody who speaks truth in this world is an absolute anathema. Absolute anathema. And of course, they don't entertain that at all, because they say that arrogance is true and truth is arrogance. That's the fundamental premise of arrogance, that arrogance is true and that truth is arrogance. That the refusal, they think that the refusal of truth to accept that is subject to change is sheer arrogance. That arrogance says that nothing can be perfect. That's crazy to say anything can be perfect. So arrogance believes that God, the truth, is totally arrogant. And that arrogance is curing God of this arrogance. God needs to accept the fact that it's not acceptable, that it's not perfect, and then God will be cured of its arrogance and then be happy. But in a society which is not working on repentance, setting arrogance down, a society that doesn't take up this great challenge of setting arrogance down, working on doing that, then this society becomes extremely vulnerable to this great, great mother goddess defense system that arrogance brings forth. It becomes so vulnerable that it takes root. It's like a cancer that takes root in a world. It's like a severe illness, like an immunodeficiency illness, like AIDS or something like that. It takes root here. We don't have sufficient humility and repentance to, like an immune system. Our spiritual immunity is so low that we become infected by this ideology, this false defense system of arrogance in the guise of a compromise from some all benevolent great mother who intercedes on, you know, in this conflict between truth and lies, and heals both of this conflict. There is no conflict again between truth and lies. There's no contest. There's no conflict. There's no contest at all with reality. Reality is absolute, immaculately perfect right now and always, and is completely unaware of anything other than that perfection, because there isn't anything other than that perfection. Any belief there is just simply a belief, an idle wish, which is just arrogance. So there's no dispute between truth and lies to moderate. None whatsoever. So there isn't any role for this moderating great mother at all. This is just make-believe on our part. We have to do the work of reason, of clarifying. We have to do the work of seeing through this all. And it's spirit that has to do this, and reason. Truth is not contrary, you know, to reason. It is what it is. It's not both truth and lies. It's just truth. That's it. No exception to it. And so reason reasons from a premise, from a true premise. Reason means extending from a true premise, a premise that is true, and then extending that into symbols and concepts so that we can feel that there's a bridge back, you know, a bridge out of our arrogance. This make-believe land, make-believe cosmos, is a dream of arrogance, and so we want to feel that there's a bridge, you know, to out of this dream, so to speak. So a little bit of full stop. I still feel fine. I don't feel any wow reaction yet. But you may be experiencing a lot of wow reaction to this. But it's helpful to see that someone is capable, even here during this terrible reign of great mother compromise, arrogance. This new world religion, which is the religion of arrogance, actually, in its most seductive form, that there's it's possible to see through all this and not be troubled by it in terms of inner reactions. Still calm. I feel like shrug my shoulders. Yeah, of course, there's no problem with any of this. We'll just stay in the wow, full stop on the wow, actually. I don't have to give a moment here. The situation has developed now. It's at such an extreme point that people are feeling that they're being forced to, you know, either convert to this this new age great mother religion of arrogance, or perish, so to speak, or be scapegoated. You know about various situations where people are converted at the point of a sword, either convert or die. And so we're very much in that sort of situation. But it's of course the great mother religion of arrogance, the great mother defense system of arrogance here, always claims to be compassionate and tolerant and understanding and not harsh and stuff. So they don't just actually chop your head off with a sword so much as they termite your existence, your ability to function here. They try to drive you into suicide, actually, is what they do. And then they can claim, well, you didn't, your will, you just had a weak will. So, and that proves their point that you need to have another birth and work on strengthening your will, because you just didn't have the will, strong enough will. Whereas actually they put you under so much pressure to crush your will. They try to crush your will. And it's not easy to stand up to that. If anyone can stand up to it here in this time, I don't know. Jesus, we're told that it will be very difficult for anyone to stand up to this pressure. And I already feel that it is that way right now. There's still a few, you know, brave voices speaking up. I see them occasionally. I see a comment on the internet. It's like, wow, you know, someone is not yet entirely crushed. That's great. But most people are now in lockstep, jackbooted lockstep with the catechism. And see, if you understand what's going on, you understand there's a catechism taking place. It's like Sunday school lessons. There's a catechism being taught in our world right now. And people are getting in lockstep with this catechism. And you look, you listen to what they say, all these different people commenting, they're basically saying all the same thing. They're all agreeing. And what they're doing is they're expressing how well they've learned their catechism, so they get a pat on the head. So this issue, everybody weighs in and says, okay, we've understood now, this is bad and this is right, this is what's wrong now, and let's do catechism. And they're getting more and more and more in agreement with one another and in lockstep with one another. And then, of course, then anyone who doesn't agree with this, it stands out even stronger, you know, contrast. Like everyone else is saying, wow, we're all in total agreement with this, and you're not, so you stand out like a sore thumb, you know, you're terrible. So the more people start standing out and being isolated like this, the more frightening it gets, the more isolated they feel, the more ostracized and isolated they feel. And this puts a tremendous pressure on everybody. I'm under the same pressure. And a lot of times you just feel like, wow, I just want to escape this pressure. How can I escape this pressure here? Now, did Jesus predict anything in A Course in Miracles? Like what, of course, that everyone's going to go this way and everything's going to be wonderful here? No, didn't say anything like that. So, you know, I don't know exactly what the outlook, in terms of Jesus, what his outlook is about this situation. My take on it is what I've just been saying in these videos. And, so the question is, well, what A Course in Miracles, why would he give that out then? If it weren't because he believed that the world was going to accept it with open arms, and it would become, everyone would return back to sanity and drop the arrogance, and this defense system of the Great Mother, and this idea of compromise, and this would win the day, and people would be returned to reason and all this. Why else would he do it? You know, well, maybe he did it to save the sheep that are ready to be saved. But why, you know, I say, well, why would he go to so much effort just to save some and not everyone, you know? And this is a question. Well, maybe that's just the way Jesus is, that he's willing to put forth but maybe it's easy for him. Maybe it wasn't a great effort. Maybe he's willing to do whatever it takes to save a few. It's very difficult. See, you think, wow, there's only going to be a few be saved here. You know, percentage-wise, it's a very small percentage, it seems like. And so why would Jesus do anything just for just a few remnants, you know, just a slight percentage, you know? But maybe he would. Maybe he would. I don't know. That's a big question. Certainly do not see reason winning out in this world right now. I don't see a speck of evidence that it is, actually. In fact, what I see is even those, what I see is this new world religion gaining complete control. I read something that Pinterest, what's it? Pinterest or something, that website of pinning photographs, and it's like scrapbooks. They have a big problem because, you know, the big majority of its users are women, and men just don't use it very much. And so they go, got to market it to men to get the advertising dollars. And women are just dominating so much. In spiritual religious teachings of the last 50 years, New Age teachings, etc., and all this, it women have dominated to an extreme extent. Sometimes it's as high as, you know, 80%, 90%. And the men that are there are just going along because their wives or girlfriends or whatever are, that's how they better say, hey, you know, I'll go along to get along here. Otherwise, they'll get dumped. So that's why they're there, usually. And so what I see taking place is this arrogance is putting up this last-ditch extreme defense of the great mother compromise of truth and lies. And so it arrogance told women of the world, say, hey, look, you have this great role to save humanity, save the world, save the universe, save everything that's sacred to us. And you have to take on this role of being a moderator. So we're going to put you need to start studying all the spiritual lingo so you can dress up this newer religion and wrap it up in the fashion of spirituality as if it were genuine. So you need to learn this moderator role. And so this is what I've seen. It is this is what I've been observing. It's very interesting. The questions that, like you see a spiritual teacher holding satsang and you look, and I've noticed, the first thing I noticed, say, wait a minute. There's 8 women for every 2 men. You know, out of 10 people here, 8 of them are women. I said, what the, you know, how is that possible? It's that way everywhere. And then I look at the questions that are being asked of the teacher, and everything. I say, why are they asking that question? That doesn't seem like a question that someone who's really after enlightenment is going to ask. There's some other agenda. What is the agenda? There's a sort of secret agenda that women have been pursuing over the last 50 years here on this planet. Not all of them, but they've been told that they're savioresses of the world, co-redeemers, and the great moderators, and that they need to, that they're the answer. They can solve the problem of conflict. And so the way they're asking these questions, I can see there's some agenda there, but it's not enlightenment as I see it at all. They're trying to get from the teacher tips from how to be a better moderator. They're looking for advice from teachers on how they can become a greater moderator and a better servants of the Great Mother, actually. And then the teacher's kind of like a little confused, I noticed. I said, like, well, I'm telling you the answer to enlightenment, and I just gave it to you, and so, you know, what else can I say? And they're still, the women are still saying, yeah, I feel that, but I just, you know, they're trying to get something else out of the teacher. They're trying to get something else out of them. You know, like, sort of like, how can I get you to accept my superiority to you, is sort of how I feel it's going. How can I get you, the enlightened teacher, to accept my superiority over you because there's this new teaching, a new religion, and a new truth about ready to be born and created. It's a new creation where now both lies and truth are true. And this is superior to what you're saying. So how can I nicely motherly way, how can I get you to accept that I'm superior to you? You know, and so it's this, there's a subtle little game going on, and this is what it is. Subtle spiritual gamesmanship is taking place. That's the mystery of women. See, they have this mysterious ability that men are unaware of, that even God's unaware of it, you see. And that is, they have the ability to integrate and join both truth and lies in a new truth. That's the mystery. Yeah, it sure is a mystery, because it's impossible. It's more than a mystery, it's impossible. And they say, oh my gosh, you can't see that, because then you'll fail to see us as attractive. Well, we don't need to see as attractive. We don't need to see bodies as attractive. We don't need to see any bodies as attractive. We don't need to see this universe as attractive. We don't need to see any value in this universe. It's all fake. This whole universe is fake, manufactured evidence, that backs up our assertion, our arrogant assertion that reality is not perfect. And also backs up our assertion that there's a process of perfecting arrogance at work here. Okay. So that's why there's all this seemingly evolution and things changing and like this, as if it's going towards some higher functionality that seems to give, you know, evidence that there is that there's this process of perfection taking place. You know, it's absolute, that, you know, it's all a dream. Of course you can have a dream and ascribe any meaning to it you want to, but it's completely unreal. Reality is not a situation of time, space, process, and form and evolution towards the perfection. Reality was created perfect. created perfect. Reality is absolute perfect freedom. I've experienced all the infinite glory of essence and idea that spirit can play with. It has nothing to do with this cosmos of seeming evolution of form, you know, and process in time and space. This is just a dream. Jesus calls it a hallucination. Yeah, a dream is a hallucination, isn't it? And yet people are under pressure in this world. Keep in mind that when Jesus came first time and told the truth, his apostles abandoned him. They abandoned him. When he was being crucified, they were up on the Mount of Olives looking down at a it was the Mount of Olives. They were at a distance. I'm not sure exactly where they were located, because Golgotha is on the opposite side of Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives. So, you know, they might have been there, but they were on a hillside somewhere. There's lots of little valleys and hills there. And because they didn't want to be identified as apostles of Jesus, because they were being hunted. They said, where are those people who used to follow Jesus? Let's put them to death too. And they grab Peter and says, here's one. We recognize him. Peter said, what are you talking about? I've never heard of this Jesus. I've never met him. I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't know him. I don't know that man. I don't know him. Peter denied him three times. And that was the rock that Jesus was going to build his, you know, mission upon, his challenge upon. So this is how frightened we are in this world. The idea that Jesus can come back to this world and we're all going to agree with him is nonsense. Hopefully we can do better than Peter did, but I'm not holding my breath. Even, you know, for me, I'm not jittery anymore, but I used to be very jittery. I said, wait a minute, Jesus, if the Great Mother sees me hanging out with you, you know, that could be big trouble for me. So the idea that Jesus coming back to this world is just going to dispel all the troubles for us is not necessarily true. Because to the extent that we're still have a continuity fear, we're going to buy more time. And the time that arrogance is selling us right now is this compromise, new creation, big mother, moderation, lie, new world religion. And we, whether we know it or not, we are all undergoing a very severe catechismal program, okay, to teach us the various tenets of this new religion. We are under remorseless pressure through newspapers, magazines, books, all content on the internet, movies, television shows, music, entertainment of all kinds, education of all kinds, socialization of all kinds. We're under relentless, remorseless pressure to learn the catechism of this new world religion. And everybody is constantly drilling one another in this world, like, hey, you know, such and such issue. Oh, yeah, that's it. Yeah, I agree. Oh, good, good. I agree, too. So we're getting the catechism. Yeah, all right, great. Yeah, we're not going to be the bad ones. We're not going to be scapegoated here. We're learning this new world religion. And you know, they're eager to say, wow, I got this new religion I can learn. Yeah, the old stuff, terrible stuff, nonsense. Now we see what nonsense it is. They left the Great Mother out, the Great Moderator, the Great Integrator of both truth and lies. They left that out completely, totally misogynistic, you know, totally discriminatory, you know, hateful stuff, hate speech. To leave the Great Mother, the Great Moderator, who can blend truth and lies into a new creation, to leave that out of the teachings of religion, boy, that's just awful. That's horrible. It's hateful, absolutely hateful. This is where they're going. This is where this new religion is going. And it's going there in a hurry, which is why Jesus is already back here. He's already back here. And pretty soon you'll thank God for that fact. You may think, well, maybe this is premature to say that. No, it's not premature at all. The amazing thing is that Jesus' return was a perfect timing. Perfect timing. He didn't come too soon. He didn't come too late. He if he came too soon, he might have diverted our attention away from studying this carefully. And if he came too late, then it would be too late for us to even be benefited from his return. So he knew this is the time to come back. So he's already back. And so this has encouraged me to keep going, to keep going, to keep going here. I don't know exactly what he's going to do, but I want to find out. want to find out. Now, this new world religion doesn't make any sense at all. It's, but we're so used to it. We're not sure. Like, whoa, what else is there? You know, what? It's like, wow, without this, you know, what would I do? You know, I can't learn the catechism if I'm not here. How can I learn the catechism? How can I be a really good convert to this new religion if I'm not a new convert? What kind of world? What can I have as my experiencing? You know, I'll miss out on the new creation. You know, this kind of thing. So we're like really jittery, you know, about this. So for me, it's like full stop in the wow is a good practice. Just like calm down from it. You know, like, oh, I'm gonna miss out on the new creation. There is no new creation. The perfection of God's creation is omnipresent, always. How can I miss out on that? It's impossible. I'll never miss out on that. I'm not missing out on it even now, even though I'm unaware of it, as we are here in this world. We seem to be unaware of it, but we're still not missing out on it. It's true for us right now. And what, thinking that I'm missing out on the fun of this new world religion? Well, how much the end game of it is this total, you're told you have to abide in total mental chaos, and that your inability to do so, your unwillingness to do so, signifies a lack of will on your part, which then claims that you need to go through another cycle of existence of strengthening your will, cycle of this hallucinatory imaginary realm of this cosmos, electromagnetic cosmos, which is just manufacturing evidence. You have to keep trying to develop a stronger will, which is futile. It's futile, right? Because you cannot combine truth and lies. They cannot both be true. So it's not an issue of will. It's an issue of arrogance. It's an issue of impossibility. It's a whimsical issue of idle wish, okay? So that's the only thing you miss out on, is the brutality of this situation. The impossibility of it. So you already know how it ends. What are you missing out on? What are you missing out on? Then you go through a spiritual path where you finally turn to the Holy Spirit and you get to help. And so I already know how it goes. So, you know, I know the movie. I've already seen the movie. You know, what do you mean what I'm missing out on the movie? I've already seen it. I've already lived it. I've already been through it. I know how it is. And so, and the courts say, well, yeah, but there's some secret, that you, mysterious secret that the Great Mother has. No, there's no mysterious secret at all. The whole thing has been exposed exactly as it is. The secret is that arrogance blames you for failure entirely. That's its secret. That's what it's not telling you. That the Great Mother blames you for failure entirely. That's the secret that they're not telling, that she's not telling you. It's all your fault. That you cannot do the impossible. That's your fault. That's a shortcoming. That something has to be overcome. You cannot overcome the impossible. That's not a shortcoming. It's an impossibility. God didn't create creation to destroy creation. And you can say, yeah, but, what about this, blah, 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 blah. No, that's all seen through. It's all self-delusion. So if you've seen the movie and you know there's no surprises, you already know the surprises, you know, why the heck do you need to see it again? You know how bad it is. There's no wonderful happiness in that path at all, that new world religion. There's no wonderful happiness. There's only this inevitable march towards you, the impossible, and then you being blamed for it. That's the only thing that happens. It's like a death march. Now you're seeing, you know, you're just... We'll keep it tightly focused here. Now you're seeing all these moderators, female moderators, now just suddenly springing up like mushrooms everywhere. It's inescapable. The NBA, the conference finals was last night. The Warrior Golden State Warriors won, and presenting the trophy. Presenting the trophy was this woman. I said, who's this? This is ESPN's moderator, female moderator. So she now is the one that presents this trophy in the World Series. The Giants, San Francisco Giants won last year. The one who was the moderator was another woman. I said, what does she have to do with baseball? Nothing. But they have to put these moderators now. This is the New World Religion. You will find these female moderators being placed everywhere, even though you say, well, what relevance do they have to the game and what how it's being? I mean, where does this come from? Well, this is a new world religion. At work, these are the priests of the new world religion, the priestesses of the new world religion. That's what you're seeing. It's exactly what you're seeing. As I have said, and their expertise is as moderators, quote unquote moderators. They use, you know. That's their expertise. Their expertise is in the belief in that they're special, that they have this special ability that only women have, of be able to be all inclusive of both truth and lies. That's their expertise. So you can see them. They're like neophytes in media. It's amazing. Well, they get them out of high school, journalism school or something, and it's ridiculous. I'm watching them and saying, they're like. Just kind of reading a script and acting like actresses, basically. And in all sports now, you have these female moderators, and they're the ones asking the questions of these experts, guys who played the game their entire life. Their whole life is the game. And now this chick out of some college who's majored in journalism is now the one who's moderating the whole thing. And she said that she's the one to ask the questions. Okay, now, da-da-da-da-da-da, huh? Oh, really? And she gets flushed with it. Oh, really? I didn't expect that answer. Oh, okay, now you. I'm going to ask a question of you. You know, moderators, 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 moderators. it's humorous. If we understand what's going on, it's not so humorous. It is very deadly intention to it. Very deadly intention to it. It's basically, these are the priestesses of the New World Religion. And they are now assuming their post, which is every single area of media information in the world. And as I said, also the spokespersons for almost every corporation now, the moderators who moderate disputes are all women now, all women. And you might think, well, it's just a coincidence. There's no coincidence about it whatsoever. This is absolutely the New World Religion. And of course, we're being told this is like the best thing that's ever happened to the world. We're finally getting it. We're finally discovering the hidden mystery of women, that they have this secret capability that we've been refusing to recognize all this time, because that they're actually greater than God, and we didn't want to admit to that, you know, that our arrogance, the arrogance of reality, refused to recognize this superior quality of women they have to include with both truth and lies, both truth and arrogance, together in a new creation. They have the ability to create a new creation, and God's arrogance has kept God from seeing this all this time, but now we're finally seeing it. You know? So we're finally making the breakthrough. This is the time of breakthrough. And so everyone's like celebrating, you know, like, wow, all the moderators, the priestess moderators are now all taking their positions. You know, we have this global church now, and the catechism is now, everyone's learning this catechism, and we're going to, you know, be safe from all our troubles forever, forevermore. This is what's being taught in the world. Now, of course, spirit will be dismayed to find out this is not true. I've already been through the dismay, because the ultimate outcome of it is, again, you're told you have to combine truth and lies, which results in total mental chaos, and then you're supposed to abide in that chaos. And well, the idea is that if the chaos arises because you lack will to combine the two. But that is not true. When you try to combine the two, you experience total mental chaos. It's horrible. It's the worst experience possible. And then you're blamed for it. This is exactly what happened to me. I was the arrogance viciously accused me and blamed me of being a complete weakling, complete failure, worthless, absolutely worthless, weakling, failure, idiot, fool, incapable of doing what I needed to do, absolutely shameful, and tried to get me to just die out of mortification of how utterly incompetent I am. And I almost did die, actually. Most terrible experience anyone can experience. To have zero self-worth, believe you're absolutely nothing. And of course, the idea of the stupid religion is that if you point out it's false, they say, oh, you're claiming that women don't have this special mysterious ability, huh? And then you're claiming that you're ruining their self-esteem, but they have no self-esteem. Well, that's utterly ridiculous. We're claiming that spirit is perfect, is what we're claiming. It's just that spirit has no capability to be imperfect. So there's no secret capability of reality to be imperfect. So we're not claiming that, quote-unquote, women, which are really spirit, is somehow completely worthless. We're claiming that they're perfect. All is perfect. So it's not the same as arrogance. Arrogance claims we're absolutely worthless, total trash. We deserve to be annihilated. Whereas what I'm saying is, no, we're all perfect. We all deserve to experience the glory of our perfection. But in order to do that, we got to set down the belief that we have some capability to be imperfect. We don't have any such capacity. Women do not have some special capacity to be imperfect, nor do they have a capacity to combine imperfection and perfection. Doesn't exist. The fact that some arrogant ability we've claimed we have, which we don't have, doesn't exist, doesn't mean that we're not perfect at all. So again, this gives the lie to arrogance's defenses, claiming, you know, oh, it's not fair, you're trying to tear them down. If you claim you have some ability you don't have, then you've got to realize you don't have it. That doesn't mean you don't have any other ability. It just means you don't have that one. We don't have the ability to change reality. Does that mean that reality then doesn't exist? No, of course not. This is utterly ludicrous. Totally ludicrous to believe that. So again, arrogance defenses are completely ludicrous. And if we fail to laugh at them, then we get trapped by them. And Jesus said, we just forgot to laugh at how ludicrous our notion was. We had a ludicrous notion. And so we're laughing now, but finally we get around to laughing at it. So the whole thing about this new religion is that they claim that women have some secret ability that men don't have, innate, inborn quality by the very nature of being women, being female flesh body, that men can't possibly understand it. Therefore, any critique from men about this is completely unfair, because men don't have this quality, and so they have no way to know what this quality is like. Therefore, there's nothing they can say about it, so they should just shut up and be quiet, or bless it and just say, yes, thank you, and worship and say, thank you so much for being here with this awesome quality you have that I don't have, that's going to save me and save everyone. And so either you just are very worshipful of it, or you just shut up. And any comment whatsoever about it, it inherently proves how you know, wicked and arrogant you are to even suggest. Why should you even make any comment at all? Because you can't possibly know about it. See, this is what we've been taught. This is the catechism of the New World Religion. I'm very aware of this catechism. I've been observing it very carefully as it's been developed over the last, you know, it's been a century actually, but the last 50 years has been very intense. So men are not supposed to have any voice at all, except supposed to be audience members applauding. Women say, wow, you go girl, this is fantastic, look what you're doing, oh my gosh, you're bringing in this awesome ability you have to combine truth and lies, and this is going to save us, fantastic. And of course, women say, well, that's not what we're doing. You don't know what we're doing. They basically say, you don't know what we're doing because you don't have this ability, so you have no way of knowing about it. So you're incapable of commenting upon it. You talk about sexism, that's the very definition of sexism, right? That the men can't possibly say anything about it because they can't critique it at all. They're incapable of it. That's the definition of arrogant sexism, isn't it? That's exactly what's taking place here. And that this is, and so we can't say, hey, wait a minute, what are you here doing this moderating job, and why are you in this position? Say, well, you have no right to even say anything about us whatsoever, because we understand our path. You can't. We understand the path we're on. We understand how to succeed at it. You can't possibly. Total arrogant sexism. The claim that females have this and some special capability to do the impossible, whereas men don't, you know. And so when men say, wait a minute, you know, this is an attempt to accomplish the impossible. You know, let's go back to reason and we have to understand we can't do this. Women say, oh no, you're crazy. How dare you say that? You don't understand. You're denigrating the self-esteem of women. They believe that the self-esteem of women is totally based on recognizing they have this special quality that men don't have, the quality to accomplish the impossible. And that if men don't recognize it, they're trying to destroy the self-esteem of women. They're warring against women. So basically, truth is seen as a war against women right now. Plain and simple. That's how arrogance has positioned itself, very cleverly. I mean, it's not that you can't see through it if you want to, but if you're so intimidated by truth, because of continuity fear intimidates you, then you're going to be vulnerable to this. Arrogance claiming that truth is really nothing more than a vicious war against women and their special ability to combine truth and lies and make a greater reality than reality. And they say basically what this new world religion is saying is that God is jealous of women. God hates women because women are superior to God. Again, we have to laugh at this. It is quite hilarious, and it's also exactly what is taking place here. So don't forget to laugh at it. And then again, how dare you laugh at the Empress with her special abilities? You're just jealous. You're this horrible, wicked, jealous God who's just dragging his feet here and refusing to go into this new creation, you know, where the superiority of lies will be seen, that God was lying all along, saying that lies weren't equally true to truth. It's just insecure. You know, God's insecure. That's what they're going to, you know, spring on you. That you're just insecure. God's insecure. That's the problem. It's exactly what they're doing. I know it. I'm experiencing it. If you stand up to God, you're just this misogynistic, chauvinist pig, and you're standing up for this jealous, insecure God who refuses to understand that he's being replaced by a higher truth and a higher creation now, and that women have the special ability to give birth to this new creation, and God is just this, you know, jealous, petulant, you know, angry, insecure God, and you, by you supporting that, you are too, you know. Now, when you go to the wall like this, like I am doing, of course you want Jesus to you know, show up and support you and say, hey, you know, you're okay with me, you're still okay with me, you know, I haven't rejected you for saying this, because the world, by and large, will completely reject this, you know, absolutely reject this. Very few people in the world will accept this and not reject it, you know, You know, you putting my neck on, you know, going out on a limb by doing all of this. Well, what else can you do here? If you don't practice familiarity with truth, you're going to be swept up in this new world religion, goddess worshiping, great mother worshiping, and for men, slaves. You don't have any right to even speak up at all, because you're incapable of relating to this. Now, they're trying to use this guilt tactic of saying, well, women were excluded from religion before previously. No, they weren't. As a matter of fact, I think the Catholic Church has been, you know, made up of a majority of women throughout most of history. And all religions have included women, absolutely. But what was happened is arrogance told women, hey, look, this isn't going to work for you. And eventually you discover it doesn't work for you. and it doesn't work for anybody. You know, that's what arrogance says. And you're going to need to have the strength and will to come out eventually and bring forth your special ability to bring about a new creation that makes both truth and lies true. So you can just play along with this religion, play along with it, but eventually, you know, you'll realize it's not true. And so don't really get into it too much. Keep your distance from it. Just pretend, be an actress, act like you're interested. So a lot of women did that. They acted, they pretended they were interested, but they didn't really get into it. They didn't really embrace it. Because arrogance told them, this is anti-women. It's not really recognizing your higher status. So what good is that? It'll fail. It'll fail you. So a lot of women acted like they're interested, but they really didn't get into it. They didn't really repent. And now arrogance says, aren't you glad you didn't repent? Aren't you glad now finally you're getting your just deserts of being worshipped as greater than God and the goddess that replaces God and with a new creation? And then, so arrogance told women not to get in, not to embrace true religion, which says the only truth is true, nothing else is true, but to pretend to act like they were interested. So a lot of that has been acting throughout history. Not all of it. Some women did embrace it, absolutely. But some did not. Some pretended, as some men pretended too. But a lot, I would say more women pretended to be interested. And why sometimes you go to church and you see all these women there and you realize they're just there because you know, they figure, well, I'm just putting in my time here, I'm buying time here, waiting until my true value is finally appreciated. Like this religion does not appreciate my true value because I have this special value of being able to give birth to a new creation. And this religion is talking about God and the one creation, and there is no other creation, and it's just not recognizing my special ability. You know, this is still the voice of arrogance. Okay, they have not yet freed. You cannot free yourself from arrogance by simply pretending to and putting on an act, and playing a role of, yeah, I'm going to church, I'm here. Okay, yeah. And in your mind, you're thinking, okay, what am I going to do when I get out of here? And, you know, this stuff. You can't do it that way. It doesn't work that way. Repentance is a serious business. You actually have to embrace it. You actually have to do it. Actually have to do it. So it'd be nice to get a pat on the back from Jesus, but it's I can never predict what he's going to do. Yeah, I really cannot. He has a better viewpoint of it than I do, for sure. So, you know, whatever he does, it's the right timing. I've seen that in retrospect, but it's frustrating because you cannot just dial it in and say, hey, Jesus, you know, give me a pat in the back. It doesn't work that way. You know, if he sees that that's counterproductive, he won't do it. So you cannot really just order it up like room service. It doesn't work that way. The dreams I've been having lately, there's nothing. You know, there's nothing there. I say, wow, that's very odd. But there's a reason for it. Maybe just staying out of the way, saying, hey, you're doing great. Keep going. I don't want to interfere with it. If I gave you a pat on the back, that might you know interfere with your you know momentum in some way. It's possible. Again, there's no way in the world I could have, you know, seen through all this without Jesus producing A Course in Miracles. I don't see any way. It's very extraordinarily difficult without this clarification. Or, you know, I could, if I was some very advanced practitioner in some religion or something, meditation, then it's possible I might be able to see through it too. But, you know, if you're not already super advanced, then I believe it would have been too difficult to see through without the help that Jesus has given here. That's why I gave the help. So we're just full stop on the wow mode here a little bit. How are we doing on this taping? Pretty good. Hopefully some of you are actually watching this. What a shame if you just ignored it, because this is very relevant information. I know the average viewership on the video is about like 9 minutes or something, and it's just like, that's ridiculous. That's about how long it takes you to eat a Big Mac, you know, hamburger. It's like going to a fast food store. Give me a hamburger and some fries, and you wolf it down. Oh, how long is that? That took about 9 minutes. Great. That's good enough. That's all the time I need to spend on it. But paying attention to God has been stigmatized here. So most people, they say, well, I'll give it a couple minutes, but the rest of the time I need to spend attention to this catechism that's taking place, because if I don't, I'll miss out on the new creation. So of course people are saying, "Wow, I can't spend a couple hours on this." What? I mean, that's a couple hours taken away from the new catechism of the new goddess religion. And if I don't learn that catechism, how can I be happy? Full stop in the wow. We just give it time, neutral thought, a little time to settle down. Settle your nerves down. Something's going to happen. I believe something's going to happen. But again, I can never dial in room service with Jesus. I just cannot. It just doesn't work that way. No matter what I think, you know, I think, wow, this is a great time, Jesus. I don't know. You know how he's going to. Go about his business. He knows his business better than I know his business, that's for sure. Click, boom, boom, boom. Let me see. I'm just trying to boost this a little bit. Can I do that? Okay. Well, it seems like a great time for Jesus to do something. For me, I don't have much work going forward. Hit a flat spot. Very bad timing. At least it seems that way. But I'm using that time to just push as fast as I can. But lack of work is not a good thing in terms of when you have issues that you have to deal with, financial issues that you have to deal with. Work is not a good thing. So I said, wow. But this is opportunity. I say, well, I don't really have much responsibility in that way. Maybe this is a great opportunity right now. So I'm trying to get myself up to speed now that I see that the next 5 weeks, I won't really have much to do. Maybe Jesus will get the ball rolling here, because we got about a year until we're going to have to go through a confirmation process with the new catechism. Basically, you know how in that Catholic Church you go through baptism, and then you go through catechism, and then ultimately you're confirmed. You go through First Communion, then ultimately you're confirmed. And so you go through. There's a process of getting into the church. Well, in this new church, this new age, this new religion, Goddess, Great Mother, moderate or compromise new creation religion, which is the religion of arrogance, is what it is. There are steps in that too to get into it. So first, you have to go through this catechism. But at some point, then you need to be confirmed. Okay, and so what I say is next, we have to about the 21st of July 2016, I believe, to really get clear about this and avoid going through the confirmation process. I believe the confirmation process will begin at that point, where there's going to be some way that you're forced into acknowledging that you've accepted this, that you've learned the new catechism, and you've accepted into this new religion, and you now are official goddess worshiper. That will take place very soon, about a year from now. Maybe just, barely over a year from now. And where you have to swear some sort of, allegiance to the new world religion. It's coming very quickly. Stuff's happening way faster than we expect. Who could have possibly believed the attack on the police that's taking place in the United States right now? The severity of it. It's unbelievable. All sorts of stuff. The severity of it now is just astonishing, what is taking place. Mind-boggling. Have people lost their minds? Do they really think that the criminals are the good guys? And so, of course, they're trying to find one rotten apple, and then they claim the whole bunch is therefore rotten, which is just so transparent that a child could see through it. It's so pathetic. Their reasoning capabilities are so pathetic. It's so dishonest. It's just astonishing. How dishonest arrogance will have you and make you think that you're like transcendently smart. Yeah, I'm so stupid that this is the new smart. This is the new intelligence. This is the new reason. What else can arrogance do? What else can arrogance do? So if there's one rotten egg, and then that means the whole bunch needs to be put under federal control immediately. Stripped of their cameras and everyone, stripped of their power. Let's empower criminals. That's what they're saying. Yeah, right. Create as much conflict as possible so we're all stampeded into worshiping the Great Mother and her ability to moderate. Of course, then she'll come on the scene and say, "Oh my gosh, my children, what squabbles you have. Look at the criminals are taking over. Terrible. What's going on?" Oh, I'm here to moderate all this. I'm here. I can solve all this. Don't worry. I know how to moderate even this conflict between truth and lies. I will moderate that and we'll blend it into a new creation. Yeah, both are true. Voila, you got this incredible, oh, wow. I didn't know that there was that capability. I never even knew that. Well, that's because you were bigoted. That's because you're a chauvinist pig. You didn't realize. You never asked. You never looked. You didn't. Yeah, but I didn't see any evidence of that. I mean, it's amazing. It's not in my reason. It's not anywhere within me. This is true. Well, that's because women are a special creation. The Great Mother's a special creation. Well, where'd you come from? What created you? Well, that's a mystery too. And that will be revealed to you once you manage to combine truth and lies. Then you'll be able to see where I came from. Oh, really? Yes. So wow. And as soon as you have the will to combine truth and lies, then the mystery that what I am, the mystery of this new special goddess, special capabilities, you will see where I came from. You'll see what created me. You will see it. You will discover. And then failure to combine truth and lies is a lack of will on your part. And you must keep incarnating and keep working on worshiping me. I will, and build your will up. And that's the only way you'll ever discover where I came from. And then Jesus says, "Oh, wait a minute. Where you came from is arrogance. That's where you came from. You're a child of arrogance. I know where you came from. Came from my own arrogance, your projection of my own arrogance." I already know that. I don't need to combine truth and lies to know that where you came from. You're just a figment of my imagination. You're a figment of my, you're just something I conjured up to try and defend arrogance. That's the answer. I don't know what Jesus is going to do again. I kind of fear, like, I hope he doesn't say, hey, you need to get out there, and we're going to have great revival. We're going to, you know, turn the tide here in the world and everything. I said, wow, I don't know, Jesus, is that really possible at this right point in history of the mindset of this world? Is that really possible? I mean, good Lord, you're going to ask me to be crucified, you know, if that's the case. So, but I don't know. I don't really know. If that's what he says is doable, then that's what's doable. I'm going to try not to doubt, you know, whatever he says is doable. He knows, again, he knows the business of salvation way better than I do. So, he's the boss. So, what he says, you know, we're going to have to try and do whatever he says. But I don't know what's going to be said. In Bible prediction and prophecy, it says this time is a time of ruination for the world, actually. And it'll be severe chastisement in this world, great troubles. And that, you know, there's different theories about what happens to the repentant ones. Either they're slaughtered, or they have to go through enormous, terrible trials, or they, you know, are somehow protected into some refuge, some sanctuary. You know, there's different, you know, beliefs about what's going to happen. Or everyone's miraculously turns away from the goddess, the great mother, and turns away from arrogance and accepts that only truth is true. But from my experience on the path, it cannot happen that way. It cannot. The continuity fear is so severe. The lies of arrogance, we've believed in them for so long that we feel we'd be annihilated if we set arrogance down. It's a pipe dream to say that everyone's going to suddenly just wake up. Oh yeah, this whole universe is nothing but a dream. Of course. It has zero value to it. Of course. There was never any shred of hope whatsoever in all of arrogance that could ever be true. And, you know, and, oh, of course. And it's all, poof, whole universe vanished. Oh yeah, of course. No problem. You know, that's a pipe dream to think that if that was true, it would have happened long ago. And there again, we're believing in some special powers of this moderator, thinking that if we worship the goddess, she'll make everything possible for us. But we don't realize what the game really is, okay? We're thinking, oh yeah, maybe, yeah, sure, the whole world can become enlightened. What we're thinking is the goddess has some special ability to bring peace and prosperity and end of conflict by combining truth and lies. That's what people who are not on the spiritual path are betting on this. What else can you bet on? What else can you bet on? God sure doesn't have the capacity to combine truth and lies. Absolutely not. Can't make them both true. So what else can we believe in except the goddess? Some figment of our imagination. So those who are not on the spiritual path, they're pretending like, oh yeah, yeah, well, I can be. I'm going to be happy just like this. You know, they're believing in some special, mysterious ability of the goddess, the moderator, who instantly can solve some conflict, which doesn't exist, actually. Otherwise, they'd be on the spiritual path trying to see through all this, and it's quite difficult to see through all of it. Otherwise, we would have done it by now. So this instant enlightenment of the world, you know, that is, to me, it's just arrogance to see it that way, extreme arrogance. It's really saying that arrogance will suddenly make arrogance true, and that the new creation will suddenly happen, which can't happen. So it's just, you know, whimsicality. But there are a lot of people, you know, believing in that. But I look at them, I say, hey, wait a minute. The direction you're going is in towards goddess worship, no question about it. And they're not saying a darn thing about all of this. A lot of spiritual teachers in the world, religious spiritual teachers, you know, the New Age teachers, they're not saying anything about what I'm saying at all. They're refusing to. I say, wow, that's a sign that you're headed toward goddess worship. And indeed, they seem to be doing just that. So how can you put faith that you know, in their belief in some big revival that's taking place here? Are there enough teachers of God to suddenly turn the tide? I don't believe the tide has suddenly turned. The defenses of arrogance are so clever and have deluded us for so long that we feel we'd lose our identity if we dropped it. We think that our identity is wrapped up in this universe, wrapped up in time, space, process, and form. without it, we wouldn't have any identity. So we cannot just summarily drop it all. It just doesn't work that way if we're not yet clear about what the two options are. You know, if we haven't clarified what the options are, it's arrogance or truth, and see arrogance as arrogance and truth as truth, how can we choose between the two? It would be a superficial. We'd be superficial about it. You know, it's like sowing a seed on, you know, shallow soil. We might have an enthusiasm for a while and say, ah, no, that's not it. So I don't know. We'll find out. We'll find out very soon what Jesus has in mind. It will be unfolded for us, you know, gradually as he wants. Gradually we'll get clued into it. But it better come very quickly or it's going to be too late. Even for me, you know, I don't think anybody can withstand the pressures here in this world. I don't see myself as being ultimately be able to withstand them at all. It's going to become so severe that the ostracism that you experience is going to be so severe where you won't have a friend in the world, and nobody will stand up for you if you speak truth in this world. So, and those that you think that you're friends, they end up teaching compromise, really hooking you in towards belief in the goddess, the moderator, the goddess of a new creation. They'll actually hook you in and pull you into that. So I don't think I can survive, stay true. I don't think anyone can here. Very doubtful. Unless you're already, you know, perfectly enlightened. You have not a trace of arrogance within you. Then, you know, you could withstand it. Example, Ananda Maima was here. Someone had not a trace of arrogance in her. And they tried to hook her into this goddess religion. This new world religion of the goddess, Great Mother. And they said, you'd be a perfect fit. We'll make you the Great Mother. They tried and tried and tried her whole life to hook her into it. And it was futile. Absolutely futile. But she, it didn't have a trace of arrogance. None. Not even a trace. So sure, someone like that can withstand it. But anything other than that, I don't think that you can withstand it. And we're certainly not in that position of being completely free, not only completely free of without a trace of arrogance, but absolutely comfortable in being not having even a trace of arrogance and not even the slightest desire to entertain that whatsoever. That was Ananda Maima. But and so she played out this game of trying to entrap her into that, and she couldn't be entrapped. So she's a great help to the world, actually showing you, you know, you don't have to be entrapped. Even showing women, you don't have to be entrapped in this. She's a great help. If some women would see that, I'd say, you don't have to be entrapped in this goddess worship. Because for me, no matter what they did to me, no matter how they dressed me up as some goddess, and then telling me that I could be the great mother goddess, she said, no. And then she refused to stay here. They said, you could cure yourself. You could remain young forever. She said, that's true, but I have no interest in that. The unmanifest is calling me back. I have no agenda here at all. And so she got old, and she, her body dry died. And they, you know, they said, "Wow!" They said, "Oh my gosh! You know, we couldn't get her. You know, Mahatma Gandhi, all of India, they tried to pressure her into being the great mother of the new world religion." And they said, "Hey, look! If you're the new mother of the new world religion, India will be then the great country that lead the world into this new religion, this new spiritual awakening, and all this." And she said, "Sorry, I have no desire for that." Whatsoever. I have no desire for anything. I'm nothing. I'm nowhere. I'm nothing. I'm never. I'm just this. I'm whatever you take me to be. But I cannot have any such agenda. I cannot follow any agenda at all. I'm absolutely free. All is already perfect. What are you talking about? New religion. Everything's already perfect. So we did have that help for those who paid attention to us. Like, wow. Just because you appear here as a female body doesn't mean you have to go along with this goddess charade. And she said, "Men, you don't have to go along with that either. And so one of her prime disciples who had been worshiping the goddess for so long, she said, hey, you know, it's time to recognize the truth. Stop worshiping the form of a goddess, thinking that there's some special truth and that there isn't. She said, there's only God. That's it. There's only God. There's not anything else. There's never been anything else. There's no other truth. In vain do you try to find that. But again, we're not there yet like that. Perfect, without a trace of any desire for arrogance whatsoever. No interest, no intrigue in it whatsoever. So can we withstand the pressure to you know, go along with this goddess religion? Can anyone here in this world? And she actually said, don't take me as example as far as what you can do, as far as being resistant to this, being perfectly resistant. So, you know, we're not perfectly resistant to it. I don't know of anyone in this world that's perfectly resistant to it. Except Jesus, he's back, and he is perfectly resistant to it. So, you know, what are we going to do with ourselves? We certainly don't want to get hooked into this religion of arrogance, which is so dastardly, actually. No matter how many petticoats you put on, it is still totally dastardly. Demanding that you combine truth and lies, and if you can't do that, it's all your fault. You're a complete failure. And then you must continue to worship the goddess and incarnate and serve her like a slave to build up your will. That's what happened. The goddess said, you got to serve me as a slave now. That's how you build up your will. I said, how in the world am I going to build up my will? Of course, the Holy Spirit also told me, no, you don't have to do that. So there's two competing advice systems of arrogance and the Holy Spirit. And I wasn't sure, you know, I tried to take both ways. I wasn't sure which one is going to actually work. And what the goddess tells you is, the arrogance tells you, that by serving the goddess, you will build up the necessary will then to combine truth and lies. And then you will recognize where the goddess came from, and you will enter into the new creation, and you'll be saved, and you'll be happier forever after. And this is what happens. You then end up trying to figure out, how do I enslave myself to the goddess so I can build up this will to combine truth and lies? And you can't. You can't. It's all a waste of time. And of course, the goddess keeps trying to mortify you and tell you you're completely worthless. You're scum. You're not, you know, you have no value whatsoever as spirit. God's worthless. You're worthless, you know. And the only way you gain worth is to serve me and, you know, do what I tell you to do, which is, you know, try to encourage others to do, you know, accept the religion of the goddess. Let's see what's going on here. Okay, one moment here. Full stop on the well. Alright. So the intensity of these videos is necessary because we want to avoid that confirmation pressure that is going to be put upon us. Right now, the next year is going to be severe catechism of the New World Religion. We're already under incredible pressure for this catechism. And it's going to become, you know, final push now to get everybody on the same page agreeing with this catechism. And then the confirmation process will begin. And that's not going to be a very pleasant process, as far as I can tell. It may be, you know, you're under pressure to be chipped, actually. That's what the Bible tells us, something like that. You know, that in order to be confirmed in this newer religion, you need to show your obedience to the goddess and being chipped so you can be monitored at all times, may be what you have to do. But it may be something prior to that, too. There's the confirmation thing. That may be just a confirmation of the confirmation, you know, et cetera, that you're really loyal. That's all coming in about a year, I think, now. This is what I see. So, you know, Jesus, do your work now. You know, there's no time to wait. There's no time to wait now. We don't want to wait because this catechism is really pressuring us. So these videos are really informing you now, very informative what's going on. You're seeing the ugliness of it. You're seeing the nastiness of it. You're saying, wow, the Empress has no clothes, you know. She's not as beautiful as I thought. And this idea that somehow we're demeaning women by just pointing out that they don't have some special ability to combine truth and lies is absolutely ludicrous. Absolutely ludicrous. We're saying that there's one spirit, and this one spirit is perfectly perfect. There's one mind, and this one mind is absolutely perfect and doesn't need any special qualities. Okay, so just pointing out that no one has any special qualities, we're also saying that men don't have any such special qualities, right? We're not demeaning at all. We're not being sexist at all. It's just ludicrous to say so. But we do have to be pragmatic and understand that a lot of women have bought into this notion that they're special. And so you cannot subject yourself to that sort of indoctrination. Then you have to say no to that. Absolutely say no to that indoctrination, that pressure of catechism and indoctrination. Say no to it. And that's not being sexist, just saying I'm avoiding the missionaries. You know, just be, you know, if there's a false religion and the missionaries are all women, and then you avoid the missionaries, say, whoa, I don't want that false religion, and then it's claimed that, oh, you're biased, you're sexist, you're discriminating against women by, you know. I mean, what is that? That is obviously the completely insane upside down logic of arrogance. You're avoiding a false religion. It's the fault of arrogance to send out all these women. Why don't you send out half men, half women, and then we'll reject all the missionaries, and then you can't say we're sexist, you know? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Of all the people of a false religion that happen to be pink, you know? I mean, you say, well, I'm staying away from the pink. Oh, you hate pink, huh? You hate pink. No, I hate the false religion. That's what I hate. So stop sending out missionaries to try and indoctrinate me. And arrogance claims that you're bad, you're guilty, you're evil, you hate, you know, you hate, you're discriminating stuff. This is their shtick. This is their shtick. Shtick of guilt. False guilt. You know, ridiculous. But very effective. Very, you know, people are collapsing right and left. No, those missionaries should learn to hate arrogance and turn away from it. That's what they need to do. So I'm just helping them. We're helping them. We're not hating, we're helping them. By refusing to go along with a false religion, we're helping them. So if you're helping someone, how can you be discriminating against them? That's ridiculous. But again, arrogance is nothing but ridiculous from the very beginning. So if we don't laugh at it, we start taking it too seriously and think, oh, wow, it must be true, you know. All right, how are we doing here? Doing pretty good. But we have to reinforce this, reinforce it, reinforce it, because we tend to get tripped up on this. But it's a trick of arrogance. Arrogance sends out the type of person to pressure you into accepting the false catechism, which you know is super nasty, and what it ends up in us feeling we're worthless because we can't combine truth and lies. And so basically we're saying, I don't want to feel worthless. And then it's claimed that we're discriminatory because they say, well, you don't hate the religion, you hate the people, the missionaries who are presenting it to you. That's your problem. No, it's not. Our problem is we're rejecting this false religion because we know what it's about. That's the issue. We reject whoever presents us with this false religion, we'll reject them. So they're trying to divert you saying, well, you really like this religion, you just don't like the people who are presenting to you, and that's something you need to realize, that's that you're guilty, that's bad of you, and that's harming you. You need to get past that. That's the trickeration of it, which is really, you know, it's silly. It's so pathetic. It's silly. But we forget to recognize how pathetic it is. And everyone's so into this catechism, thinking that this is their salvation, learning this. They say, oh, no, you know, you're bad, you're bad, you're bad. And you kind of start thinking, maybe I am bad. You know, this is, so even me, I can feel like maybe I am bad. Maybe there's something wrong with me. Maybe I'm being discriminating. How come I'm not accepting, you know, this? It works on your mind. It works on your mind. That's the problem. I'm just telling Jesus. I hope he understands this. This is my experience in this world. I'm seeing how it works on our minds, and we cave into this pressure. It's a guilt pressure. Very deceptive sort of guilt pressure. And even if we say this here, the pressure is still there. It's not like the pressure disappears by hearing this. It's still there. Wow, the sun is high in the sky because it's... Days are quite long right now, which is great. California's warmed up a little bit, you know, but still quite cool. The problem is you cannot convince the catechumens, those who are following the catechism of this new religion. They when you try to bring this to their attention, they feel that you're interfering with their salvation. They're not going to listen at all. They don't listen anymore. So most of the world just refuses to listen. So you might, you know the truth and explain it, but who's there to reaffirm what you said? He says, oh yeah, thanks for saying that, or thanks for reminding me of this. You know, if you don't get any thanks for reminding one another, if we're not exchanging, thank you for reminding me of this truth, thank you for reminding me, then we feel we're all alone. We feel we're all alone, and nobody has our back. We're no way can relate with anybody, and you feel you're being cut off from relationship, from relating. And that's a horrible feeling. So I say to Jesus, start relating with us, for God's sakes. You know, what are you waiting for? We're not finding anyone to relate with in this world, hardly at all. I'm putting all these videos out in the world, you know, and how much feedback am I getting? You know, to say, wow, thanks for reminding me of this. Thanks for reminding me of this. If there's no feedback at all, I say, well, maybe nobody is being reminded. You know, nobody's going to be reminded at all. Yeah, and maybe a little bit of feedback, but it's so small. You know, just like, wow, I guess everyone's crushed here. So maybe Jesus can come and tell us, you know what, there's a place where nobody's crushed, actually. Where your awareness and clarity will be valued, and people relate, be able to relate and say, oh yeah, I see the same thing. I understand exactly what you're talking about. Whereas here you feel like you're crazy because nobody can relate with what you're saying. You start inferring that you must be crazy. You know, this is a problem. If the pressure is on that way, and we can crack. I mean, it's possible. You can just collapse under the pressure. Absolutely, that's possible. Be a fool to think that oh no, not me, I can't collapse. No, it's ostracism. No relationship at all here can be very, very, very intense feeling like of collapsing. So maybe there's a place where their sanity reigns, and you say, hey, this is how I understand arrogance and what it tries to do, and they say, yeah, we see that as absolutely, we're very clear about that. Thanks for caring enough to see through it too. It's wonderful, but you're sure not getting that in this world now. It's just almost unbelievable. This world has gone into a complete spiritual collapse. All the while claiming they're building, that they've finally found the will to finally find the answer, which is this non-existent compromise between truth and lies. A new creation, combining the truth and lies. And the world thinks that it's finally found the will to accept the answer, worship the Great Mother and her creation of all-inclusive truth and lies. And so the world thinks it's going towards salvation. They finally found the will. What's actually happening is their will to see through this scam is totally collapsing. Totally collapsing. Even very intelligent people have collapsed into this. Because it takes more than intelligence, it takes discipline, it takes actually time and effort. Being smart is not the only part of the equation. You have to be very determined and perseverance and severe effort, actually. Sometimes if people think that they're really smart, they feel, I don't have to work that hard. Because everything's come easy to them in life, right? I'm so much smarter than everybody else. I don't have to work hard. But on the spiritual path, you have to work with great determination, very severe effort, great perseverance, plus being quite smart, actually. But that determination and great severe effort will make you very smart. You become very wise through that. Very, very wise. Better than smart. Better than Mensa. You don't need to belong to Mensa at all. In fact, most people belong to Mensa and never even make the effort, spiritual effort. They say, why should I? Life is easy for me. I can win here. I'm so smart. I find that these winnings of like teams, you know, whatever's winning, what do you think winning? It doesn't mean much anymore because I realize we're in this world, we're being pushed into a horrible impossibility, horrible dead end of darkness, a collapse of spiritual will. So, yeah, you know, it doesn't mean that much anymore. I used to think, wow, great, your team won. And now it's like, yeah, you won. Okay, whatever. That's not stopping, you know, this horrible Franken monster, or monstrous, actually. You never hear anyone saying monstrous, do you? It's always monster. All the bad stuff is always using the male pronoun, and the good stuff is the female pronoun. Now, you don't hear monstrous. Again, this the new world religion is showing up in commercials, has been for a long time, where the female is always the one that solves the problem. The man's always the one with the problem, however that problem is portrayed. They're very creative about portraying it. And the female is always the one who, with her special superior ability to the man, comes in with the answer. Oh, let's do this. Oh, I would have never figured that out. It's amazing. You know, how did you know that? She sort of smiles mysteriously, like, well, it's just, you know, my inherent superiority, of course. And your inherent inferiority, of course. These are all commercials, scripted by the New World Order. Actress is an actress portraying this propaganda, this catechism. It's catechism. Commercials are very severe catechism, actually. That's why the Holy Spirit told me, stop watching television. Back in the late 90s, and no more, you know, stay away from it. Otherwise, you're going to fail, for sure. Because it's a very severe catechism. When you watch television, you are being indoctrinated with the catechism of the New World Religion to an extreme extent. You can't hardly escape it. You say, well, I'm watching golf. You know, a couple of guys, you know, knock this little white ball around. But the commercials are extreme indoctrination, very extreme. Same with baseball games, same with any sports now. Extreme indoctrination. Including the woman is always the moderator now on these shows. In golf, like the Golf Channel, woman moderator. The woman moderators are everywhere showing up now. Baseball shows. All sports. You get these guys who've been working for 30 years. They know what they're talking about. turn on the channel next day, there's this new moderator just out of college, and smiling and all perky, and you know, I'm the special person here to help moderate now and bring you to enlightenment. And now they're the ones in charge of the show. It's like, what? Who do they know? Well, no, they're part of the New World religion. They're the priestesses. Gatekeepers, the moderators that help us with our catechism. What do priests do? Help you with catechism, right? They help you bring you into the teachings of the religion and help keep you rehearsing, keep practicing. That's what priests do. So these priestesses are there for the purpose of our catechism, teaching us the New World religion. That's what they're doing. So the questions that they ask, the way they cut off this answer, say, wait a minute, that's not the answer I was looking for. They're like priests. That's what they're priestesses of a New World religion. Oprah was the example, that setting the example for a lot of this, actually. This is what you need to do, ladies. This is how you get with the New World religion. Follow my example. And so this is all planned ahead of time. It's all been planned out. And as these moderators, of course, they have the microphone. They have the microphone, basically. Here's the question I want you to answer, okay? And then they give you the answer. Whoops. And it's funny, when the guys don't answer the question they asked them, they say, whoops, that's not the question I asked you, is it? Like a priest would say, you know, that's not right. You know, this is not how we do it here. So that's not the question I asked you. and you can feel the, like, my God, this is they don't get it. They're failing this new religion. They need a lot more help here. She's like, I feel sorry for them. Wow, you didn't get the memo, did you? This is the reaction. Somebody didn't get the memo. Oh, how embarrassing for them. Well, don't worry, we'll help you out, little boy. You know, we'll help you out. Mother's here, don't worry. Big mother's here. And we're just getting you ready for her, you know. When you see it this way, then the whole thing, you realize, oh my gosh, there really is a plan here taking over this world. There really is this defense system of arrogance. This really is happening. You know, all this is actually, it is what's going on. And the mystery is resolved. You know, you don't feel like you're in this confused mystery at all. Otherwise, you're like really angry and frustrated and irritated. I don't understand what's going on, you know. How come this is happening? So I just turn the channel, but now basically no matter what channel you go, you can't escape it. You can't, you know, it's just everywhere now. It's all pervasive in our society. It's all pervasive. It's pretty funny. You can't get a single vocation in Ireland, and yet you can get millions of priestesses. I mean, not everyone, but so many, many, many women are now joining the vocation of the sisterhood of priestesses of the New World religion, of the Great Mother, who is going to give birth to a new reality, combining truth and lies, you know, supposedly, according to arrogance. So there's millions of women jumping into this vocation all over the world. They're just everywhere you look now, there's some 20-year-old woman who's in charge of the microphone moderating these 60-year-old men, you know, telling them what idiots they are and how out of it they are and how they need to learn how to respond the way that she wants them to respond. Like, okay, here's the official catechism, here's the affirmation, the great of what we're affirming our beliefs. I believe that such and such and such, and we're supposed to say, I believe such and such and such, and I believe this and this and this. So they're basically training us now in this catechism. Trying to get us to forsake God. That's what they're doing. They're trying to get us to forsake God. As the only way to salvation is you got to forsake God. That God is some horrible invention of some male chauvinist who's trying to keep women, you know, blah, 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 blah. And of course, we understand that arrogance invented an imaginary God of arrogance, and that some men and women throughout history, many have been following that. That doesn't mean the true God doesn't exist. It doesn't mean that religion isn't pointing towards the true God. The New Testament certainly points towards the true God of perfect love. Absolutely. So yeah, the new catechism of the world is to forsake God, which is to forsake ourselves. it's a religion of forsakenness. And I know how it ends. I've experienced that feeling that you're completely worthless, with no way out. You know, this is how it actually ends. And then you turn to the Holy Spirit, so it actually ends with you turning away from it and deciding this isn't the answer. But wow, you know, and then you get with it, and it takes a while to get free of it. It can take a while. So, powerful videos. Now, hopefully you're being empowered by these videos. You know, don't forsake God. Do not forsake God. Just because there have been all these false images that arrogance have made of God doesn't mean that we should forsake God. God is perfect, just as we are perfect. All of creation is perfect. We were created perfect. There's never going to be any change in that. God has not entered into any contest with us whatsoever, never will. All is still perfect. We are still completely loved, completely accepted. All is will be. Everyone is included. No one is rejected. Even those who pursue this goddess religion to the utmost extent, they're still also perfectly included and loved by God. Perfectly free. No restrictions. We're all perfectly free. No judgment upon any of us. We're just playing out this ridiculous, whimsical game right now that seems so fraught with with devastation of God, but there isn't any such devastation of God. There is no new creation whatsoever. So just don't forsake the truth. Don't forsake the truth. And hang in there. Keep processing this. Keep processing it. And you know others would reject this. I say, okay, well, we'll see what Jesus will do. He's back. Realize he's back, and he's going to do what he's going to do, whatever it is. It's to our benefit. It'll be to the benefit of those who have done this work, who've not forsaken God. It'll be for their benefit. Many are forsaking God right now, going in that direction. And, you know, I'd like to be able to change the direction for all of them, but it seems like the pressure is so severe now in the world. It's I'm not being very effective, which is quite saddening. Compromise seems like a wonderful plan, doesn't it? Let's combine both. Solve the whole thing. Solve. That seems so tempting, doesn't it? That's the candy. Poison candy, you know, it seems so tempting. It's bright, it's shiny, it seems sweet, you know. It's like, oh wow, how easy, just let's combine the two. Yeah, how can we do that? Oh, there's a special someone special who has the ability to do that. Oh, all I gotta do is trust in them. Oh wow, that's easy. Great, I feel better now. I'm not worried anymore. It seems very, right? It's very tempting. Very tempting. And I got all these beautiful priestesses smiling with all their, you know, makeovers and shiny, bright, and young, and saying, just accept that there's this special capacity we have, and the goddess will save us all. All you got to do is just, you know, agree, go along with it. It's so easy. And it's like, wow. Okay. You know, that's that looks like that's the answer, huh? It's like they're selling you a car without an engine. Look at the upholstery. Look at the paint job. You know, look at this radio we got here for you. Look at the wheels. Wow, what a car, huh? Man, you're gonna go places in this car. It's like you get in the car and turn the key, and it's like nothing happens. You say, well, what's going on? There's no engine. Well, that's your fault. You should be able to make the car go without an engine. That's it. Did you lack a will? What's the matter with you? Yeah. What's the matter with you? Gosh, you're terrible. You're worthless. Yeah, so I hope this message resonates throughout the whole world, but it doesn't seem to be. It's just the way it is right now. We're, you know, in this horrible, horrible collapse of spiritual will on this planet. Going in the wrong direction, thinking that that's an example of spiritual will. It's not. It's a symptom of a collapse of spiritual will, is what's going on here. So, okay, wonderful. Wonderful for all those who've heard this, a full stop in the wild. Let it sink in, let it sink in, let it sink in. Just say, wow, I didn't think I'd ever hear this. Yeah, I didn't think I'd ever hear this. This is pretty cool. Very nice. And it's been, I've enjoyed making this video, as I do all videos. And we'll see what Jesus will do. Stay tuned, stay tuned. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still...